Good morning, and welcome to our Sunday worship service. I am Martha Schmidt, and I'll be your celebrant this morning. I am a long-time member of this congregation, but I am a new member of the new worship team, which is called Worship for Transformation. And that's what I will say about that for now. I'd like to extend a special welcome to all those who are joining us for the first time. We're very glad you're here. If you've come in person, normally you would receive a welcome packet with an information card, but Margaret tells me, oh, we have found some? Margaret Dibble told me that we are out of them this morning. Usually we have them, but it looks like Washira has them. Okay, excuse me on that. If you fill out and drop this welcome packet into the offering basket, we will be in touch with you to support you in finding your way into our community. If you are joining us online, there's a link on our website to an electronic version of that same card. Our welcoming committee members have yellow name tags and can answer any questions or point you toward additional information. Whether you are new or not, please consider staying for coffee and conversation after the service, either downstairs in our fellowship hall or in our Zoom room. Today we will be using some of our words of welcome for a mini mantra meditation. So as you say the words, I invite you to pick one word or phrase that speaks to your heart or that you really connect with, and keep it in mind. Now we will say our words of welcome together. Whether this is your first or your thousandth Sunday with us, and whether you strolled, rolled, zoomed, ran, or danced in, we are glad you chose to join us. We are one people of many beliefs, identities, origins, sexualities, and genders. All are welcome here. Did you pick a word or phrase? Oh, I had you meditate ahead of my words. But I don't think it will hurt to do it again. Now, for the next 30 seconds, I invite you to bring a moment of meditation to our words of welcome. If you would like, take the word or phrase you selected and silently and slowly repeat it in your mind over and over again. Allow yourself to dwell in that word or phrase, using it as a mantra. Now we will take a moment to say hello across the technical divide. We're going to show the people joining us on Zoom. If you are at home, please turn on your camera. Now people at home, wave. Now people who are attending the service in our building, it's your turn to wave. We do have three announcements. Well, the first one's been taken care of, which was the welcome packet, which Washira will have out in the foyer. Washira will be out in the foyer after service at a welcome table, and then he will go upstairs for a small group meeting in the library, which is one floor up. The meeting is intended for any new members that have questions or are interested in more information about the church in a smaller setting, and any other people are welcome to go as well. It's not just for new people. And Ginger has an announcement that she wants to give.
Good morning, I am Ginger Yoder, and I am the Director of Family Ministry at this church. And I'm also one of the people who is on our safety team, which is looking at all of the ways that we're providing physical and emotional safety in our church. And one of our big projects has been working with our insurance company, the local police station, and other entities to see how can we create physical safety in this building. And everyone greatly suggested that we have security cameras. And after a lot of research, we have come and a decision and have implemented a security camera system. So we want to just everyone to know about how this works in case you have any questions. There are now cameras at every external door, and so we can look at every angle. And there is one actually here looking at all of you. They are providing 24/7 monitoring, but they're only downloaded and saved if an incident happens. So if you're walking around the building or doing something, unless there is a break-in or some vandalism or something occurs, then we aren't saving that footage at all. So I just wanted to make sure everyone knew how that worked as we are recording. We felt that was an important thing that people knew. We also owe Ryan Urey and Will Fontaine a huge amount of gratitude for making this project happen. Hi. So let me or any of our other safety team members have a question. I see Marcus is here and he's the chair of the committee. So if you have questions, let me know.
We preface our service by acknowledging our church was built on the ancestral homelands of the Nimiipuu, called the Nez Perce by the French-speaking traders, the Palouse, and the Stitsa-Umpsh, called the Coeur d'Alene. Let us pause and remember that we live on ground that is sacred, ground that was stolen, ground that cries out for justice and for responsible stewardship. May our remembering help us find the courage to do our part to restore wholeness to the earth and all her peoples. We are hoping that people joining us via Zoom have a chalice or a candle to light and something to light it with. Just as we did with our words of welcome, today we invite adding a moment of meditation to our chalice lighting. After we light the chalice, the camera will zoom in on the flame, and I would invite you to focus your attention on the flame as a visual meditation. Let's light our chalices together. In the light of truth and the warmth of love, we gather to seek and seek to share. Songs of hope and love arise. Now, if you would like to, softly gaze at the flame. Look at how it flickers and moves. Notice if any thoughts, emotions, or memories connected with the chalice, candles, warmth, or light arise. Allow them to drift through your mind. Gently keep returning your focus to the little chalice flame for 1 minute.
Okay, thank you. So this summer, we are having a series of services focusing on various elements in our worship services. My name is Lauren Brown, and I'm also a member of this new worship committee, Worship for Transformation. And I am excited to have a chance to speak to you today. One of the things we talked about in this group is looking at the different elements of our worship service and bringing fresh attention to and exploring what a particular element may have to offer us. As you may have guessed already, today we are exploring the time for meditation. We will be bringing a meditation lens to various parts of the service today. Tara Brach said, "Paying attention is the most basic and profound expression of love." And in her final collection of essays, the poet Mary Oliver wrote, "Attention is the beginning of devotion." There is so much in the world that is grasping for our attention. Meditation is one of the tools or spiritual practices available to help us become more intentional in giving our attention to something like the present moment, the inner landscape of our thoughts and feelings, or loving kindness towards a group or individual. So here are a few questions to ask yourself during the service today. Why do we have a time for meditation in a worship service? How do you feel about the time for meditation? Have you had a significant experience with meditation? So let's bring our attention now to the experience of singing. I invite you to rise in body or spirit as we sing our opening hymn, The Meditation on Breathing, which is number 1009.
Thank you.
to settle in and get centered now. I invite you to get as comfortable as you're able. You may want to stretch or adjust how you're seated or shake out a little tension. Whatever you need, just try to give yourself a little bit more physical comfort if that's possible. And now I invite you to notice, if it feels okay to pay attention to your body for a bit, to notice a place inside of you that feels like a center. And just breathe your attention there, with your attention there, if you'd like. You might notice the presence of love at this center. See if it's there, and breathe into it. With each breath in, notice love at the center. And then I invite you to notice the edge of the out-breath, noticing love at the center of each in-breath, and then noticing the outer edge of each breath you release. You might bring your attention to your own edges, finding a boundary that marks the edge of you. Perhaps it's your skin. Maybe it's a bubble of energy surrounding you. Perhaps it's somewhere inside, closer to your center. Wherever you find that boundary is okay. Breathing in and noticing the center. Breathing out and noticing the boundary. You can play with this practice, breathing, noticing what happens with your center and your edges as you stay with them and give them your attention. Sometimes our boundaries want to be pulled in close for protection. Sometimes they want to be big and spacious and roomy. Both needs are real and deserve our respect. As you attend to your center and your edges now, you might use your breath to help mark the boundary that is right-sized for this moment. Take a few breaths there. And when you're ready, I invite you to come back to our shared space and to notice again who is here with you. Each of us, an individual with their own center and their own boundaries, each one part of this larger collection of beloved companions, all of us part of the larger whole with love at the center. We are so glad you are here. And now I invite you to stay in this moment of groundedness as we have a gift of music. such a powerful song. Imagine all the people living for today. Imagine all the people living life in peace. In February 1968, the Beatles traveled to India to a small village in the foothills of the Himalayas to study with Maharishi Mahesh Yogi, a guru who had taught about the power of transcendental meditation. While he was there, John Lennon wrote several letters where he advocated for the spiritual and creative benefits of meditation. In one of those letters, he writes, "Meditation takes the mind down to that level of consciousness which is absolute bliss, heaven. And through constant contact with that state, the peace that surpasses all understanding, one gradually becomes established in that state, even when one is not meditating." If John Lennon could have been here with us in this service, I hope he would have enjoyed it. Thank you for participating in the various types of meditation that we have woven through the service today. I would invite you to reflect on your experience as we have tried meditations using mantras, an image, sound, guided instructions, breath, silence, and music. How have you felt during the moments of meditation? Is there a particular practice that really resonated with you? Are you wanting to learn more about a particular approach to meditation? Will you incorporate some moments of meditation in your upcoming week? In preparing for this service, I turned to meditation on several occasions to try to ground myself and shift my focus. The past few weeks have felt crammed with things grasping for my attention. We spent a week in Utah visiting family. Then we all got sick after the trip. Everyone's recovered now. I've had multiple trainings and presentations to prepare for and give at work. New school years are about to start, both for my kids and the university where I work. Yesterday, I spent the morning as a volunteer helping as thousands of new students moved into their dorms at WSU. And I'm guessing, like many of you, like me, have been spending a lot more time watching and reading news related to the US presidential election during the past 3 weeks. Oh, and also the Olympics are happening. So my mind has felt pulled in 100 different directions. Can you relate? So when I needed to shift my focus to be able to gather my thoughts on meditation, I tried using meditative practices. An obvious choice, right? but even though it was obvious, I still needed to remind myself to implement those mindfulness skills. It wasn't automatic. It took practice. So I took deep breaths. Sometimes I closed my eyes. I pictured my mind becoming like the smooth surface of still water. Several times, I pictured all of you. I held an image in my mind of all of you sitting here in the sanctuary and joining in on Zoom. I imagined us sitting in meditation together as a community. And here we are. We're having that moment. Here we are sitting in community, exploring the power and potential of meditation. And I truly believe that meditation is powerful. So let's explore together how meditation might help us individually and as a congregation. Let's consider how more meditation in the world might lead to more peace in the world. A good place to start is a definition. The etymology of the word meditation in English goes back to the Old French and then back to Latin, connecting to the Latin verb meditare. I don't know if I'm saying that right. I don't speak Latin. meditare, which means to think, contemplate, devise, ponder. The Wikipedia entry defines meditation as a practice in which an individual uses a technique to train attention and awareness and detach from reflexive, discursive thinking, achieving a mentally clear and emotionally calm and stable state while not judging the meditation process itself. Not a bad definition. It's a little technical, not terribly inspiring. Later in the Wikipedia entry it points out that it's difficult to define meditation because there's no universally accepted definition. It states, meditation has proven difficult to define as it covers a wide range of dissimilar practices in different traditions and cultures. In popular usage, the word meditation and the phrase meditative practice are often used imprecisely to designate practices found across many cultures. These can include almost anything that is claimed to train the attention of mind or teach calmness or compassion. There remains no definition of necessary and sufficient criteria for meditation that has achieved widespread acceptance within the modern scientific community. So that kind of makes it sound like the lack of a universally accepted definition is a problem. And perhaps it does make it difficult for researchers who are trying to conduct their research. But in everyday practice, in using the power of meditation in our individual lives and in our communities, I don't think it is a problem. I think meditative practices are broad, diverse, expansive. Meditation might be connected more to an attitude, an attention, awareness, rather than a particular method or technique. And I'm guessing that as a bunch of Unitarian Universalists, we're okay with that, right? Just as we're not united by a particular creed, but rather connected through a shared commitment to a free and responsible search for truth and meaning, we can take a similar approach to meditation. Rather than focusing on like a doctrine of meditation or debating about what is or isn't actually meditation, I would invite us to bring deep loving attention to many of our daily activities. Meditation as an approach, as a way of looking at something. So I know we have quilters here. Can quilting be a meditation? Of course. We have gardeners. Can gardening be a meditation? Absolutely. We can bring an attitude of meditation to baking bread, washing dishes, painting with watercolors, folding laundry, listening to the rain. We can meditate while sitting, walking, dancing, swimming, eating, or breathing. So what would you like to do as your meditation over the next few days? Where will you cultivate an attitude of meditation? In her research for the Center for Contemplative Mind and Society, Maya Doerr organized a variety of reflective practices into what she conceptualized as the tree of contemplative practices. Her tree includes practices like journaling, qigong, storytelling, volunteering, lectio divina, and meditation. And all of these different practices are the branches of the tree. The roots of the tree, the foundation of all these contemplative practices are one, awareness, and two, communion and connection. In an interview, Maya noted, the roots are the most important part of this tree to pay attention to. Everything on this tree should have both of these aspects. These are the things that shift an activity from being just something we do into being a contemplative practice. So let's consider those two roots with the question that I asked at the beginning of the service. Why do we often have a time for meditation in our worship service? So I believe that having a time set aside to meditate together in some format increases our awareness, our self-awareness, and our awareness of others. It gives us an opportunity to become more aware of our thoughts and emotions. It helps us become aware of stillness. And I believe that in opening our awareness has the potential to take us deeper into the theme of the service. Time for meditation also helps us with that second root, communion and connection. It is so beautiful that we meditate together, having a shared experience as a community. There's also the potential for meditation to create the experience of communion, perhaps communion with God, with spirit, or perhaps communion with our bodies, with nature, with time. Ultimately, I think meditation is a practice that helps us commune and connect with love. We give the gift of our attention in an accepting, embracing, non-critical manner. That's love. It's as if meditation is a way of giving a hug to the present moment. You know, one of those nice long hugs where no one feels the need to pull away or end the hug. Imagine a world where we all consistently try to develop this self-awareness and try to experience this communion and connection. Imagine what this looks like in a classroom. Children more aware of their emotions and how they experience them in their bodies. Children learning how to shift their focus to their breathing when they are distressed. children feeling a sense of connection as they meditate together. And I know that there are teachers and curriculum developers that are working on this, trying to figure out appropriate ways to bring these skills into the classroom, incorporating cultural differences and neurodiverse affirming approaches. Imagine what this looks like in a family. Parents more present when spending time with their kids. Families learning to deeply savor a shared experience, free from distractions, putting their phones away for a minute. And there are folks working to develop trainings on mindful parenting. There are professionals trying to figure out how to make this accessible, knowing that not all families have the privilege of free time, knowing that it is hard to practice meditation if you are dealing with significant housing and food insecurity. They're trying to bring it to families. Imagine what this looks like in government. Politicians practicing deep, attentive listening rather than just rehearsing what they're going to say next. Government leaders taking moments to calm their breathing and watch their thoughts and emotions for several minutes before making decisions that will impact the lives of thousands of people. Congressman Tim Ryan believed in this, believing in the power of a mindful nation. He developed a monthly meditation session for members of Congress and their staffers and would bring in meditation experts. Imagine what this would look like in the workplace, in business and law firms, in busy restaurant kitchens. Imagine what this looks like in churches, synagogues, and mosques. Imagine what this looks like in universities and research labs. Imagine what it looks like in the military. Imagine what it looks like in medicine, in doctors' offices and surgery rooms. Imagine what this looks like in your life. So again, I would invite you to think about your upcoming week and pick a task, an event, or person that you would like to approach with an attitude of meditation. Bring awareness, communion, and connection to this task, event, or person. Bring love through the gift of your deep and purposeful attention. You may want to use something to engage one or more of your five senses to help signal a time of communion. Maybe you drink tea, listen to a recording of ocean waves, smell lavender, watch clouds drift by, or slowly rub some lotion on your hands. Maybe you focus on your breathing for a few slow, gentle breaths, and then invite yourself to be lovingly present, fully present in the moment. Imagine as we leave the service today and create these mindful moments during the week, imagine them like little golden stars and see them lighting up through Moscow and Pullman and beyond. In the midst of clouds of worry, anxiety, fear, conflict, animosity, and apathy, there emerges a collection of shining pockets of light. So let it be. And now, please rise in body or spirit as we sing our closing hymn, number 1031, May I Be Filled with Loving Kindness.
Thank you.
Please be seated. Our closing reading today comes from Mary Oliver, a poem entitled On Meditating, Sort of. Meditation, so I've heard, is best accomplished if you entertain a certain strict posture. Frankly, I prefer just to lounge under a tree, so why should I think I could ever be successful? Some days, I fall asleep, or land in that even better place, half asleep, where the world, spring, summer, autumn, winter, flies through my mind in its hearty ascent and its uncompromising descent. So I just lie like that, while distance and time reveal their true attitudes. They never heard of me, and never will, or ever need to. Of course, I wake up finally, thinking how wonderful to be who I am, made out of earth and water, my own thoughts, my own fingerprints, all that glorious temporary stuff. And now we'll end with our musical benediction, There Is a Love. Please join me in the words for extinguishing the chalice. We extinguish this chalice that it might glow gently in our hearts. May it light our paths as we leave this place. May it guide our way until we are together again. May you have moments of meditation, of mindfulness, of being so deeply in the present moment and loving the world. And please join us for coffee downstairs and come back next Sunday.